Our story begins as so many do. At rebirth. A ghost found her guardian, and he was awakened. An exo, designated as saint. These are the tales of his existence after his memory was wiped for the 13th time. His story leads us to the Battle of the Six Fronts, when the defenders of the city lined the walls to defend against the House of Devils. From the fires of this battle, legends would be forged. The Lords of Iron, Skorri, Felwinter, Radagast, and so many others were amongst them. But Saint Fourteen was there as well, and he held fast against the onslaught of Fallen. However, along the walls a different legend was also rising. Beside the Lords of Iron, a great warlock held off the Fallen onslaught and brought the power of the Void to bear against them. His name was Osiris. When the battle had ended, the speaker took note of both him and Saint Fourteen. The three stood as powerful symbols of peace, guardians that could stave off the darkness and bring hope to the light. Saint Fourteen was a machine of war, but he also understood why the war should be fought. There is no greater example of this than on the day that Saint Fourteen was walking through the streets of the city and was approached by one of the singers that he had defended. The singer told him, "You protect me and I do nothing in return." Saint Fourteen humbly requested him to sing, and the singer understood. Acts of kindness and fraternity like this are what made Saint Fourteen such a symbolic figure. He believed that we all had our purpose, guardian or not, and that we could all work harmoniously to make the city a better place. He was the champion of the people, and such was his relationship with the speaker that they called each other father and son. When Saint Fourteen saw Osiris on the field of battle, he saw something that he believed to be unique. He saw most warlocks for what they were, philosophers. But the question had passed his mind many times. Were the warlocks simply philosophers, or could they be warriors too? With this, he questioned whether they would fight for the light or meditate on its purpose. But in Osiris, he saw something different. He believed that he had found something truly rare, a warlock of great pragmatism, one who was not afraid to act in order to achieve results, one who cared for practical solutions and not theoretical dabblings. Saint Fourteen believed that this trait had to be put to use, and so he called, amongst many others, for Osiris to be elected to the vanguard. The speaker, seeing Osiris's prowess in battle, agreed despite the words of the Concordat stating that he was misincarnated by a faulty ghost. And so it was. Three guardians walked as allies. But the peace that they had bought would not last long. The Battle of the Twilight Gap came, and the city was left devastated. In spite of the tides of Fallen that assaulted the city, Saint Fourteen stood vigil and defended it with Osiris once again. Despite the victory of the Twilight Gap, the city was left weakened and desperate. Many guardians lay dead, and the question remained among the ashes of the conflict: how will we keep the city safe if the Fallen should attack again soon? These times of adversity brought out the true character in many individuals of the city and the tower. It is here that Osiris and Saint Fourteen both chose to act, albeit in entirely different ways. Osiris believed that if the city's defenses were not reinforced, that they might fail to defend them against another wave of Fallen. So he brokered a deal with the renegade Sunbreaker Titans, mercenaries who defended those who could pay enough. Commander Zavala believed that the cost of working with the Sunbreakers was too high. He believed them to be nothing more than thugs who happened to have been reincarnated as guardians. He refused to support Osiris's deal, and gained the loathing of the Sunbreakers as a result. They were no common thugs. They were warriors of light, titans just as he was. Just because they did not defend the city did not mean they were not also the warriors that fought the darkness much like he was. Even with this dent in his plans, Osiris was not finished. While Saint 14 had stood with the citizens below, Osiris had begun all this time to inquire into darker knowledge. He dabbled in Thanatonautics, Ahamkara lore, Xur and the Nine. He searched for the answer to the question that had haunted him. What was the true nature of the darkness? For surely you can only hope to conquer that which you know. Eventually, he had had enough of waiting. One day he entered the Speaker's chambers. Within those walls, Master argued with Apprentice, and even though they entered as friends, they left as enemies. Osiris departed and formally began a period of exile, taking his most loyal followers willingly and leaving lasting impressions upon the Tower. The Tower would search for him for many years, but to no avail. Osiris had vanished. And whilst Osiris left the Tower in exile, Saint 14 turned to the defense of the city and pondered. There was a principle held by the Titans of the Firebreak Order, of which Saint 14 was a part. It is known as the Firebreak Calculus. In other words, if I choose to stand my ground in a certain place and fight until I die, how much good will I do? Saint 14 pondered such an idea and looked to his city. Like many in the Firebreak Order, he believed that he could lead the enemy away from the city and that he could keep the Traveler safe in doing so. Firebreak Titans were a controversial order throughout the history of the city. They believed that the Battle of the Six Fronts was a failure. They had lost an opportunity to charge enemy lines and wipe them out for good. Saint 14 would not let the same mistake happen again. He would follow in the footsteps of Jaggi and Radagast, two warriors who had led hosts out at the end of the Battle of the Six Fronts in order to reclaim the stretch of land outside the city. But Saint 14 would go one step further. After the Battle of the Twilight Gap, Saint 14 went to the Speaker and demanded that he be allowed to crusade against the Fallen, to punish those that would threaten the safety of our walls. The Speaker was not easily convinced, but he trusted Saint 14 like he was his own son. And, as a result, Saint 14 was given the Speaker's permission. But, in his pursuit of the enemy, the Speaker would always remind him of his duties to return and to defend the city that loved him so much. And so it was. Saint 14 left the walls of the city and did battle with the Fallen. He crushed their positions outside the walls, and as the houses fell to his might, the tower ignited flares to show who had retreated. Cold teal for the House of Winter, stark gold for the House of Kings. But Sulcus, the Kell of the House of Devils, would not retreat. And so he and Saint 14 clashed in personal combat. The Kell was strong and overpowered the Titan. He was held aloft by one of the Kell's long arms and choked. But even as his neck was crushed, and his vision began to forsake him, the light had not left Saint 14. With his light still fading, he summoned all that remained, every last effort. He pulled back his head, and with a single mighty blow, he crushed the Kell's skull with a single beat from his own. After this final blow, the Kell lay dead, and Saint 14 looked upon his ghost.
Ghost.
He's dead, Arid. So that's it? We're done now?
We are. Get me the Speaker.
Opening his channel. Stand by.
Is that you, my son?
It is, Father. The Devil Kell Sulcus is dead. This war is over.
Such courage and power, the greatest ever to brace these worlds. You bring all of us peace. We will light the final flare, Devil Red. They will all know what you've done.
Father, I don't think I have the energy to return. I'll rest here, and come back to be honored when I return.
Of course, son. But...
there's something still concerning you. Did more fall in march on the city?
No. Not this time. I have word that Osiris was seen on Mercury, the Caloris Basin. He's turned his mind back to the Vex.
Mercury? Too many channels to know. You activate one, you start to feed its veins. He threatens our peace.
Your duty, my son, you must never forget.
I cannot. Ghost, prepare my Vex arsenal and plot a course for Mercury. That old man's about to wake up hell.
After this, Saint 14 left in pursuit of Osiris, and was never seen again. Where he has gone, who knows? Though we cannot find him, his legend lives on in the songs of the city, the paeans written in his name. For he was Saint 14, son of the Speaker. He walked out into the demon light, but at the end, he was brighter.